Welcome to the state capital, Albany, New York. This marketplace in New York State was being taken advantage of without regulation. Shovel-ready construction projects, education, healthcare. We have to do everything humanly possible as legislators to make it a fair and more equal society. Hello, I'm Neil Breslin, and this is Capitol Reports. I am the senator from the 46th Senate District, which includes all of Albany County. You know, a little over a year ago, as insurance chairman, we began to discuss what could we do in the area of autism. There appeared to be tremendous gaps in the law. There had been autism bills, autism spectrum disorder, that had been floating around the legislature without much success. So we did our due diligence and made it our goal to make sure we came up with some very positive and comprehensive autism insurance. And here to discuss that with us today is Peter Bell.
Good morning,
Senator. How are you, Peter?
I'm doing great. Thank you for having us.
Could you tell me a little bit about yourself and your connection to autism?
Well, first and foremost, I'm the father of a child that has autism. My oldest of my three children, Tyler, who is now 17, was diagnosed just after his third birthday. I decided to leave a career in corporate life about 6 or 7 years ago, and I'm currently the executive vice president for Autism Speaks, which is a very large advocacy and science organization dedicated to helping to improve the lives of those who live with autism.
And as you know, I was not that familiar with Autism Speaks, but I've become very familiar with them over the past year, and I think I would not be wrong if I said that there are probably as many different points of view on autism and how to treat it as there are days in the year.
That's very true. In fact, there's a saying in our community that once you've met one child or person that has autism, you've only met one child or person with autism. It's a very heterogeneous disorder. Right. And in the same vein, there are multiple perspectives and views on the condition itself.
Right. If you don't mind, I'd like you to describe some of the problems that you found mm-hmm. with your child growing up
sure.
in terms of coverages and treatments.
Well, my son is 17 now, and so he was originally diagnosed, as I said, right after his third birthday. So this was 1996. And unfortunately, back then, most people believed that autism was not treatable. In fact, most people, when they got a diagnosis, were told that they would be lucky if they would be able to get into their early adulthood without institutionalizing their child. Mm-hmm. We live in a different day, fortunately, today. We absolutely know that autism is treatable. And one of the things that we are trying to do, and really a movement that started about 3 years ago, is to reform autism insurance. When my son was diagnosed, we literally were told goodbye and good luck. There was no prescription. There was no, here's a plan, here's what you need to go and do. We were really left to put together a program ourselves. But we knew, even back then, that one of the most important things you can do for a young child that has autism is to treat them with behavioral treatments, specifically applied behavioral analysis, which for now 20 or 30 years has been the gold standard for how you treat an individual with autism. Unfortunately, that is a treatment or a therapy that insurance has flatly rejected compensating or providing coverage to families. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, though, we now have 21 states in the country who have passed laws in the last 3 years, and we hope New York will be the next. Insurance type of coverage is really critical to producing the best outcomes for these kids. A lot of people believe that there's not a lot you can do to change the course of a child that has autism. That's completely false. These treatments will make a profound difference in the vast majority of individuals that have autism.
Now, for people listening, I hope that by the time that this you are seeing this, that we will have an autism bill. It has passed the Senate.
That's right.
I expect it to pass the Assembly, and I expect the governor to sign it.
Wonderful.
How will this bill that was sponsored by me in the Senate, mm-hmm. with the help of both sides, there were senators, Republican senators and Democratic senators who
right.
got on board and put away partisan differences
right.
for the goal of making this a reality.
That's right.
How would this have affected, this bill, have affected your son if he had it available to him when he was a young child?
Well, I want to first of all point out that 61 of your colleagues, 60 actually, including right. yourselves, felt unanimously that this bill needed to go forward and become a law. So thank you very much for being the primary sponsor and the real leader in this. What this will do is it will change the outcome and the opportunities that the families and their children who have autism, these children will get better. They will have access to these treatments that unfortunately for many have been unavailable. There are some families who have taken out second mortgages on their home, even third mortgages. In fact, I just became aware of a family down in South Carolina that is considering giving up custody of their child to the grandparents so that they can take advantage of a law that exists in South Carolina. So what families have had to go through in order to get access and get the treatments that absolutely everyone knows will help their children is heart-wrenching. And I believe that this will change immediately once this law becomes in effect here in New York. Mm-hmm. I also should point out that there are a number of employers who are here in New York who will have employees in other parts of the country who will benefit from this law as well. So we really do see New York as being on the cutting edge. We believe this is probably one of the most comprehensive landmark pieces of insurance legislation in the country. And again, I can't just stress that we're so grateful for you being the champion of this.
Right. I should point out that whenever we do a healthcare bill, and we make it a mandate, as we are now making. And if you drive up insurance premiums for the insured, the people who buy health insurance, if you drive them up by 1%, there's statistics that say you might drive 30,000 people off the rolls.
That's right.
So it's a balancing act.
Sure.
And we hope that I know there's some data available that said that the costs would increase somewhere from 0.5% to 2%. Hopefully right. it's on the low end.
Right.
And the experiences from South Carolina have shown it'll be on the low end.
That's exactly right.
And but having said that, we do have some restrictions in the bill, and we want it to be the treatments to be evidence-based,
right.
clinically proven. And can you describe how that would be helpful or hurtful if that's the case?
Well, I think it's important that there is a standard that insurance has in terms of what they will provide coverage on, and we're not asking for anything that's different than what they provide in terms of coverage for other medical conditions. There does need to be a standard in terms of what meets the as you called it, evidence base. And evidence base is all based off of peer review types of research. So we do believe that there are many, in fact, there are at least 24 types of treatments that are available that meet the criteria for evidence base that will, as I said before, have a direct impact on those children that have autism. But the other thing is that we need to kind of get rid of this idea of just because a child has autism, they can't be treated, or that the coverage shouldn't be there. That is certainly something that we experienced early on. When an insurance company found out that our child had autism, they deny everything. Mm-hmm. And I think that has certainly changed. It's absolutely critical that we make sure that we follow the rules and that we follow what other insurance companies are providing to other individuals and the conditions that they have.
I know that people looking in will say that they've read articles in the lay press and they might have remembered seeing that autism existed in 1 out of 300 or 400, and then they might have noticed that it began to steadily go down to 1 in 150. Now I've seen 1 in 110, and sometimes seen it below 1 in 100.
That's right.
Can you tell us the status of research to determine causes?
Well, unfortunately, we still don't know what causes autism. There's been a lot of research put into that question, and unfortunately, we don't have the answers at this point in time. What we do know is that there are multiple causes, that there are a lot of different reasons why an individual will end up with a diagnosis of autism or an autism spectrum disorder. We do know that there is a strong genetic basis, but we also believe that the environment really plays a critical role. In fact, there was a study that just came out last week that is showing that even when you look at the genetics of autism, there are both inherited versions as well as what they call de novo mutations, which occur post-conception. So I think the scientific community really recognizes that the environment is something that needs further research and is most likely behind this very significant increase that we've witnessed over the last 20 years. There was a study that was published in December of last year by the CDC looking at the prevalence rates across the United States for autism. That's where the 1 in 110 statistic comes from. And in some states, that figure is well below the 1 in 100. I think what it does point out is that we still really can't explain at least 50% of the increase that has happened in the last 20 years. And that increase is about 600%.
Particularly if you find vast differences between states.
Absolutely.
To identify environmental factors that may exist.
That's a very good point. Some of that could be because of access and how easy it is to get to a doctor and so forth, but I think your point is right on that we have to look at, you know, what is the difference between Arizona, for example, which has one of the highest statistics of prevalence, and a state like Alabama, which is at the lower end of the group of states that they looked at in this study.
Now, speaking from your role with Autism Speaks, how important is it to have New York have a bill that you can then tell other states that New York has been in the vanguard?
It's absolutely critical. We have a great map that shows all the different states around the country that have passed insurance laws. Some of your neighbors, specifically New Jersey and Connecticut and Vermont, have all passed laws really in the last year. And so we're looking forward to making New York a green state very soon. But I think a lot of other states are going to look at New York and look specifically at the bill that's here and hopefully follow suit. One of the wonderful things about this bill is that it doesn't have age caps and it doesn't have dollar caps. And those are really very important things for our community, because autism doesn't go away when you turn 18 or 21. And in fact, a lot of those adolescents and young adults still require these types of treatments. And so New York really will be at the forefront because of that. And the fact that they're going to follow the evidence-based model is a really critical thing, too.
Right. Can you tell us, in the statute, it calls for the Department of Health to be involved, and it will be an ongoing determination of what treatments should be available. And really, autism, from a medical point of view, is still in its infancy. So we're still looking at new treatments.
That's absolutely right. So we don't have to wait for there to be further developments or new parameters or guidelines. As new treatments become available and they meet the criteria for evidence-based and peer review, then they should theoretically also become available and will be reimbursed by the insurance industry.
And I have every expectation that the Department of Health will be a positive gatekeeper. Will be there something saying we were looking for the best treatments and not holding treatments up.
Absolutely, and we look forward to working with them to make sure that they have access to the latest information so that they can make those decisions as quickly as possible and make sure that the treatments that are available and will truly in fact help the community are given that permission as soon as possible.
Right. Peter, I can't tell you how much I appreciate you being
thank
with
you
us
for
today.
Having us here, and thank you for all you've done.
Autism is such an important part of the healthcare, our responsibility in the healthcare delivery system. And Autism Speaks has been there from the beginning. And as you know, because there are so many different points of view, there were different times during the past year plus where we weren't sure we were going to reach our goal. Mm-hmm. And I want to commend you and Autism Speaks for being with us every step of the way so that we could have positive health care reform in New York State dealing with autism.
Thank you. And I also want to just say I hope our community can rally around this and continue to work together to bring these treatments and the coverage that the families will benefit from. And it's an open invitation for anyone.
And I really hope the families tuning in today will really look in the paper for the time that you'll see Peter Bell and myself behind the governor when he signs the new bill for autism in New York State. Thank you and have a good day.